Welcome everybody right round Australia to the last in this series of The Big Gig. Oh, that was very unrehearsed, that was very good. It's very nice. We've got a very big show on tonight of some terrific international guests and a show that we're really proud of, so it's great to see you all along. And hasn't it been like really a disgusting week in the news? I mean, sometimes it's very difficult for comedians to come out and do, you know, funny routines when so many bad things are going on in the world. I mean, I just want to say one thing, you know, on a serious note. Did you know that all of us in this audience tonight, had we been in China in this amount of people, you know, this group watching this sort of show, we would be not an audience, we would be a massacre, right? So, all those in China, solidarity, yeah? Good luck. Yeah? Actually, the one thing that you feel about being in Australia, it used to be years ago for our parents and their generation before, that Australia was sort of a warm, snuggly place, a little cork bobbing in the ocean at the bottom of the world where you could escape all this stuff, but you can't escape anymore, you see. And you feel so helpless. And what can we do? I mean, I know what I do, like any other trendy, middle-class, left-wing wanker. That's me. I go out to lunch, right? Before I can discuss it all with my friends in a really kind of a meaningful way and get somewhere. But you see, the thing is that you've got to do these days, it can't be just any lunch, it's got to be an ideologically sound lunch. That's a very difficult thing to do, you see. So I leave my South African diamonds in the safe. I don't wear my Panama hat, okay? Right, I don't drink French champagne because I really care about what the French are doing in the Pacific, right, okay. I don't drink Swan Lager because Bondi's an arsehole involved with Pinochet in Chile, right. I absolutely refuse to go on the Israeli army diet because it's just the same as eating Palestinian. No way, no way am I going to have anything to do with fish paste from Canada. No particular reason, I just hate fish paste. And of course you can't eat Kentucky Fried Chicken because they're all battery hens, right? And then you can't eat McDonald's because the beef that's in McDonald's hamburgers is grazing on land that once used to be Amazon rainforest, okay? So where do you go for lunch, right? I know, you go to a health food shop. Bullshit, they're appalling. You know, you walk into a health food shop and the atmosphere is very quiet and reverential. It's like a church. That's because they both operate on the same principle of very heavy guilt, right? And the girls behind the counters are all psychology university graduates. They never rock up to you and say, oh, g'day, love, you know, what'd you like today? It's always, is there something you really feel you particularly identify with for lunch? And these girls are so slow. They're always rushing out to breastfeed the baby or offer up a bit of incense to Baba Ganoush or something. By this time, your alfalfa sprouts have turned into a lawn. And the sort of food you get, what, alfalfa sprouts on carrot leaves on rye, it looks like a compost heap. It's the sort of thing you put in your bag, you walk back to the office, half an hour it's turned into a science experiment and eaten all your biros. Not the sort of place you want to go for lunch. And you finally do get all your food, you put it in the non-plastic bag, right? And you're walking out the door and you look up, there's always a poster of a starving Ethiopian child looking at you. So what are you supposed to do then? You get your lunch, you put it in the mailbox, you mark it to Ethiopia, to whom it may concern. The best thing about being ideologically sound is that you get to lose a lot of weight. And girls, isn't that the most important thing after all? Oh, no, I'm so ideologically sound, it hurts. We're going to swing on now with our fabulous band. We've had them here from the very beginning of the show. And they've stuck with us through thick and thin. We love them. Make them welcome, the Swinging Sidewalks.
A one, two, you know what to do.
Everybody get ready to go. Sway in the mood, rock and roll.
And that's all.
I mean, tell you, that's all.
All you gotta do is rock and roll, that's all.
Oh, well, about the time I got plenty to spend. If the clock runs down, we'll wind it up again. And that's all. I mean, tell you,
that's all. All you gotta do is rock and roll, that's all.
About the thing that the teacher at school, if you can't rock and roll, you're a natural fool.
That's all.
I mean, tell you,
that's all. All you gotta do is rock and roll.
I mean, tell you,
that's all. All you gotta do is rock and roll, that's all. All you gotta do is rock and roll, that's all.
Good evening. We interrupt this to bring you a news update. Treasurer Paul Keating has blamed the economic crisis on the lust of average Australians for imported goods. Some people have been putting Portuguese sardines in school lunches, shouted the Treasurer above the clink of champagne glasses in his Paris hotel suite. Mr. Keating has urged all Australians to stop eating immediately. Golf. The rainbow warrior of Australian golf, Wayne Lightning Truscott, was a late scratching from the Folies Bergère Nakasone nude mixed doubles night golf fiesta on the French Riviera when he mislaid his passport and his traveller's checks and his number six widgie and couldn't find them anywhere. The disgruntled Lightning will instead tee off at the Gold Coast with the usual rabble of pop singers and politicians on the make in the Save the World Nippon Rainforest Environmental Handicap Photo Opportunity Open. Golf is an environmental statement, trumpeted Truscott. If only the world would replace its divots and retrieve its balls from the watercourse, we would have something to leave the junior players. We don't own this planet after all. We've just got associate club membership. The Amazon basin can breathe easily again. Abseiling. Australian abseiling supremos have expressed concern for the fate of the national cross-country abseiling team, now 3 days overdue from a trek to jump off every peak in the Warrumbungles. Team leader Aldo Rubberhip Spinetti showed clear signs of depression in an earlier interview this week. Sometimes everybody feels like jumping off a cliff, sighed Aldo, but at least with abseiling you can wrap your thighs around something that won't let you down. Back to Animal Farm.
Light 30-something is now ready for boarding.
start without me, honey buns. I'm rostered. I'm totally rostered. I'm rostered off with a type of air sickness, which means you're not going to get me up in one of those things after 3 hours sitting on the runway because some air traffic controller has just phoned in to report a complete screaming nervous breakdown. And why wouldn't he? His job is like a traffic cop trying to coordinate a six-way intersection while juggling 24 balls and 16 plates and 3 chainsaws and 6 hand grenades with the pins out. Ah! And if he even pauses to take his medication, he might accidentally steer our meat wagon into a plane of Melbourne hairdressers, fresh from Fiji, and send them ploughing into the upper suburbs, spraying the light industrial zone with flaming polyester shirts and hand-carved fertility gods. You know, they always survive crashes. People find them embedded in their roofs for years later. Oh. Oh. I'm sick. I'm sick of the prospect of a plane of merchant bankers with a rendezvous with an underage hand job in Singapore. Hitting an air pocket and throwing me into Tom Cruise's groin. Oh, on the in-flight movie screen. Oh. And me screaming, is there a doctor on the plane? And there is. He's the one that's impaled himself on the courtesy swizzle stick of his martini. And has got both arms broken and is in need of urgent medical attention. Bastard! So I'm taking a holiday. And guess what? I'm not going to fly. I'm not going to fly to Asia, our nearest neighbor, with a bunch of brain-dead vegetarians who bring their own free-range fruit and their own Swiss Army knives to eat it, and who slobber into their oranges and complain about smoking for 16 hours. I'm so sorry about the... I'm so sorry about the... I'm so sorry about the smoking. And I'm not going to fly to Paris with moist, squirmy honeymooners who order a split of Great Western and giggle and consummate their love on the toilets. Him sitting, her waiting for the knock on the door. Oh. Him standing, her with 1 foot jammed in the Kleenex dispenser. Oh yes, oh yes, oh yes, oh yes. No, thank you. You can stuff that up, your hand luggage. No, I'm going home by train to Mother in Dapto. Mother used to fly bombers in World War II. From the factory to the killing fields. And when she wanted the heating turned up, she pissed in a flying suit. And when she wanted a cup of coffee, she lit the metho camp stove in the bomb bay out the back and made it her bloody self. And when I hop off the train, my ears won't pop. And the station master will say, "G'day, love. Good to see you back. Show us your boarding pass. Can I carry your bags?" And Mum will be there with a leg of lamb in the early cooker and real peas and real spud simmering in real lard. And Dad will be down the back shed with his collection of engine parts. And we'll sit and we'll talk and they'll complain about the flight path and I'll apologise. And later, Mum and I will pause over a flag and a port for about 4 hours. And then in the morning, Mum, who's got a sense of humour like a steel rabbit trap, will wake me up saying, "Bing bong!" And I'll unglue my eyes and she'll be standing there with 2 pots. Coffee, tea. And she would have been down the backyard with the chooks getting a couple of eggs and some of Dad's tomatoes and she would have cooked them just right. And then she would have sprayed the lot with super glue, bung them through the spin dryer and jammed them into a plastic ashtray and served them up to me saying, "I just wanted you to feel at home." Chuck this crap to the dog, and I'll give her a hug, and we'll sit down and we'll have a coffee and a cigarette. And that's what I call flying first class.
Over the years, Australia has given the world many great things. There's been Howard Florey, the inventor of penicillin. We've given the world Patrick White, the great Nobel Prize winner. And more recently, we've sent off into the great beyond Los Trios Ringbarkers. As it so happens, someone sent them back. And we don't know what to do with them either, but here they are, Los Trios Ringbarkers.
Looks good.
Over there from you. Could you stay here? Would that be okay? I'm really punch you. I'm just going off from you.
Ha ha ha!
I'll read to you. Natasha was listening and considering. So what then she said? Look what you've done. You've completely turned his head. What do you want of him? You know you can't marry him. Why not, said Natasha, with no change in her attitude. Because he's so young. Because he's so poor. Because he's a relation. Leave off talking nonsense, said the Countess Barish... Countess Barish... Barishkovodkovich. Did you just sit on that?
No, you just sat on it. Oh, you saw me. Sorry, I got out of control.
I'd just like to apologise, ladies and gentlemen, for the... Sorry,
I didn't...
I'd just like to apologise for the routine and just like to apologise for the whole show, really. Sorry.
Can we do this again?
Good evening. Here is a late news update. Treasurer Paul Keating has blamed the nation's disastrous trade figures on Mr. and Mrs. Australia's hunger for luxury goods. Some treacherous Australians are putting their kids into Taiwanese thongs, bellowed Mr. Keating above the crash of cash registers at a Frankfurt antique fair. Mr. Keating has ordered all Australians to stop wearing clothes at once. Golf. Play in the Save the World Nippon Rainforest Environmental Open was disrupted when a naked female streaker dashed onto the fairway of the fourth hole and chained herself to the nearest competitor, Wayne Lightning, before swallowing the key. The beautiful blonde interloper, Miss Fifi LeBoom, is believed to be protesting against the increasing commercialization of golf. Fifi has raised a number of pressing points, announced a flushing Truscott as he struggled to free his putter from Miss LeBoom's python-like embrace. And I shall be considering our respective positions very closely. Truscott has sent his caddy downtown for bolt cutters and is playing through with a 6-stroke discount for restricted movement, even though commentators agree that he and Ms. LeBoom greatly resemble two dogs in rut on a hot summer's day. Abseiling. The army has been called into the search for Australia's abseiling team lost in dense bushland under the leadership of cross-country novice Aldo Rubberhip Spinetti. Spinetti is not a complete idiot, said a search spokesman. He left behind him a trail of snap-frozen fettuccine. Unfortunately, the wombats got it. Searchers fear for the team suffering a cold night since they were clad only in singlets and tight little shorts that show off their attributes to advantage. Perhaps they could huddle together for body warmth. Everybody else is. Back to the herd instinct.
Now, I guess most of us would be trying to forget about the 70s, wouldn't we? Because the 70s didn't bring a lot of great stuff. What did it bring? Jumbo cord flares, bean bags, and also the worst 70s group in the world, Excalibur. Excalibur have been playing in a show which has been a big hit in Sydney and is in Melbourne at the moment. And it is, we're going to cross them now. They've been playing in Masonic halls and lodges for about 10 years now and nothing's changed. We're going to cross to see Excalibur in Living in the 70s at the National Theatre in St Kilda. So here they are, Excalibur, Living in the 70s.
All the lonely people. up and from. And we live like in the church and we faith in our belong. And we live like in the church and we faith in our belong.
The person who were chewed out of it. I'm reading a very fantastic book at the moment. This is a book called Stark, and it's written by one Ben Elton. And I'm very, very excited to have Ben is actually on the show tonight. I'm very... Yes, fabulous. I mean, the ABC spends all this money, but really, is there any point? Talent will out in the end, truly. I'm very excited to have Ben on the show because last year, myself and the Doug Anthony All-Stars were privileged enough to travel to Britain and be on the final ever episode of Friday Live, which Ben hosted. Ben is, well, amongst his many writing credits, he was co-author of The Young Ones, which was fantastic success here. And he also was author of The Blackadder, which I know ABC viewers will be very familiar with. He's also, as I say, author of this, and he's here at the moment to promote his book and make us feel good. Make him very welcome, Mr. Ben Elton.
Yes, indeed. Thank you so much, Wendy, for that sterling introduction there. I just want to make one thing clear very early. There's a lot of audience participation on this show, and that's good, getting people involved. Very hippie, I like that. Personally, I don't do audience participation. I don't dig it, because in Britain, you know that the act... Do, 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 do.